Welcome to the Smart Investing Show, sponsored by the SEC registered investment firm Wilsey Asset Management, a fiduciary firm owned and operated by President Brent Wilsey, who's been putting client needs first for over 40 years. The Smart Investing Show has been giving unbiased financial information for over 27 years on local radio stations right here in San Diego, providing you with fundamental analysis on stocks and investments you want to know about. Now, here are your hosts, Brent and Chase Wilsey.
Well, hello and welcome to the Smart Investing Show. I'm Brent Wilsey, president of Wilsey Asset Management. Great to have you here today. We've got a lot of great things, as usual, to talk about. Well, we had spending numbers come out, and are you spending like other consumers? We're going to share with you what those numbers are, how the tariffs with China could play out over the next few months. We'll discuss options that could happen on that, what could happen. That's a big concern for a lot of people. And then also, too, is inflation continuing to cool? That's another thing we'll talk about, because that's a concern now because of interest rates, what's going to happen. So many changes coming up with the new administration coming in. So we'll be talking about that. And we'll can't cover everything today, but throughout the weeks, you keep listening to the Smart Investing Show or catch our YouTube videos on the Smart Investing Show. You'll be informed of what's going on in the economy, investing, everything. Go to Smart Investing Show on YouTube, and you'll see more information there. And Chase, what do you got today on the companies?
Yeah, companies we're looking at today, we're going to look at Honeywell International, Domino's Pizza, Bristol-Myers Squibb Company. As always, we're going to look at the valuation ratios, look and see what the debt levels look like, and come up with our target sell price as well to see if it's a potential buy. So excited to look at those three companies. I'm going to preserve the stories for why we're looking at them until later on, but definitely intrigued to look at these businesses.
And there are some stories behind those businesses, and that's why we pick on things that you could invest in. Maybe you should be selling. Maybe you should just look at. We'll go over those. But let's talk about, are you spending like other consumers? Retail sales in the month of October showed an impressive gain of 2.8% compared to last year. Now, with lower gasoline prices, gas stations were a major negative as they declined 7.1% compared to last year. Now, again, if you're a consumer, consuming gas is a great thing, but it did decline, did bring down retail sales. If this group was excluded from the headline number, retail sales would have been up an even more impressive 3.7%. There were several areas of strength as gains were quite broad across various industries, but non-store retailers, well, that was up 7%, and food services and drinking places, which was up 4.3%, well, they continue to lead the charge forward.
Interestingly, we've talked about this a lot. I've been waiting for this moment, but both furniture and home furnishing stores was up 1.5%, and building material and garden equipment and supplies dealers, which was up 2.8%, showed annual gains for the first time in many months. I can't even remember the last time I think they had positive gains. It might have been like 2021, potentially.
It's been a while.
I mean,
yeah.
It's been such a hard period, and that's just going off memory. I'm not sure the exact moment that they started to turn negative, but I know it's been very, very difficult times for those two groups there. With that said, I wouldn't necessarily say these categories are particularly strong, but it appears they may have finally bottomed. Actually seeing, again, positive gains is a big, big benefit, I would say. With that said, I do believe they could be areas of strength in 2025, considering they have both been depressed areas for a couple of years now. And I believe people will look towards remodeling their home and kind of spending on that home improvement arena next year. Overall, for the whole retail sales report, though, this is further evidence that the consumer remains healthy and willing to spend in this economy.
And again, we've got good news, and I think people, whether you're Republican, Democrat, for Trump, against Trump, whatever, I don't care. People are like, I'm glad the election's by me, and I feel better no matter what. Probably people on the other side probably don't feel as good, but they feel good it is over.
Yeah, I feel good that it's over. And I mean, also, I was going to say, this was during October.
Oh, that's right.
You know, people out there saying, oh, well, you know, people are all stressed out about the election. So I think somebody was saying people were watching less football because they were so worried about the election.
Yeah.
Well, clearly people were still shopping, even if they were worried about who was going to be president of the United States come 2025. So I think that may even potentially show there could be continued room to run in retail spending if people no longer have that concern.
And that's a great point, because then that's after the election for November. And then the report will be released around, probably December 10th, December 15th or something, which will, I think, fuel the rally more. Because we had the Trump rally. I think that's cooling off. Then I think we'll have the Santa Claus rally. And this could be information on retail sales. It could come in, I'll guess, 3, 4%, pretty high number. And I don't see gas going back up. I see just good things, and I think it's going to cause a good rally in December.
I don't know. I might take the other side of the coin on that.
What do you mean?
I don't think things will close the year because of the retail sales and because of the strength of the economy. Obviously, we saw, on Friday, the market was down, 1.5-2% because technology was dragging down all of the markets, essentially, even though we had these positive retail sales numbers showing the economy still doing okay. With that said, I still do think we'll have a good close to 2024 because I think there's still potential. And I would never bet on this. I'm just saying. I think there's potential to have more euphoria. There's still a lot of people that are all googly-eyed over, Tesla, all over the AI-type trades. Right. I don't think that's done. Now, full disclosure, we don't own Tesla. We don't own anything in AI. But I just think there's going to be more to that as we close out the year because I think people are going to have that positive outlook. Now, what that means for 2025, I'm not quite sure. But I agree with you. I think we'll have a rally to close the year, but not because of strong retail sales.
And actually, I did make a mistake, and you brought up a good point. Not the markets. I look at our portfolio because our portfolio has no tech in it.
Yeah.
And I think tech could have problems. But, we talk about retail sales. That's going to benefit our portfolio. It's not really going to benefit tech that much. So, tech has taken a little bit of a hit here recently. So the markets overall may not do well, but if you invested properly, I think you could do well in December.
I still think everything's going to do well in December. I really do.
You think what?
I think everything's going to do well in December.
Oh, everything.
I think it's, I don't know. I think there's just a lot of the, what do they say, the animal spirits are running wild.
Yes. And, it feels good, the holidays, and you're all
but
happy,
I want to be very clear. I'm not trading on that perspective. This is just my feeling on that. My actual investment thesis is to not get sucked into the hype. So we're not going to do that, but I would not be surprised to see things rally as we close out 2024.
And I guess I'm assuming that people have been with us for a long time and they have a nice portfolio built up that do well. If you're sitting in cash or you're doing other things, that's a whole different story. Because we will say that we are having a very hard time to find stuff to buy now because things are expensive.
Yeah.
So, well, let's move on and talk about how the tariffs with China could play out over the next few months. I'm beginning to get questions from people who have concerns about the tariffs on China products, such as when will they start? How much will they be? And should I buy products such as appliances now before the tariffs on China begin? Now, these are all great questions. It's important to understand that tariffs cannot be placed until after the inauguration of Mr. Trump. It is possible on his first day that he could be one of the many things he will do when he is officially the president. It is, however, possible that he may hold off on tariffs because the purpose of tariffs is to force equal trade or free trade with China. And Mr. Trump may want to use tariffs as a negotiation tool. In 2023, the trade deficit with China was $279 billion. Mr. Trump wants China to import more goods from our economy, which was only $148 billion in 2023. And I did say billion, not trillion on the last one, right?
Yeah, I believe you said billion. Yeah, trillion would be crazy.
That would be crazy.
This could come from such things, though, as agricultural products. And based on the amount of oil we could be pumping in 2025, we may have more oil than we can use here, and maybe China will purchase some of that. There are also other products as well that will be on the table. It should also be noted that last time Trump was in office, China's economy was very strong. And they were not as willing to negotiate. Fast forward to today, and the Chinese economy has weakened. This could mean they would be more open to talk on trade to help out their economy. We know they've had a lot of problems.
Right. Real estate.
Yeah, real estate has been atrocious over in China. No one knows exactly what the new president will do or how much the tariffs will be, but if you need to buy goods that are made in China, your window of opportunity, well, that may be running out.
Yeah, and this is so important because this is really going to drive, I think, 2025. And, we talk about how I believe we'll be pumping a lot more oil. What I think also is going to happen is that President Trump, when he becomes president, he's going to clamp down on Iran. I don't know how he's going to do it, but he's going to do it. I believe that China gets a big amount of their oil from Iran. So the deal could be like, if you need to stop buying from Iran.
And Russia.
And buy from us, and then we have a trade agreement. We'll buy your products to help out your economy. So he's going to do something that is going to be what Trump does.
Yeah, I mean, it's I always hate to play the game of trying to guess what he'll do, which is why we're not traders,
right.
And why we buy businesses for the long term, because frankly, nobody knows what it's going to look like. I just know something will happen.
Yeah.
And you got to be careful trying to, you know, I would never pin all my bets on one thing one way or another, but it is something that is going to be changing next year. There's no doubt about it.
And the reason why we look at this is not to do a trade, but to say, is it a safe environment to invest? And can I invest in businesses that will do well over the long term? Because if he does put these tariffs on here, they're 60, 80, 100%. The economy falters. It doesn't work. There's going to be very few businesses that will do well. But I think he has plans in his head. I do believe we're pretty close on what he's going to be looking at. But who knows for sure? But something positive will be done. I mean, that's why he had the market rally, because they know he's going to do some positive things there.
Well, you just have to be cognizant of what's in your portfolio. I know last week we talked about Five Below, and I think Dollar Tree or Dollar General was the other one. And
oh, did you hear about Apple? That they're saying that if Apple doesn't get a deal to have their products not tariff, I guess an Apple iPhone is going to cost like $250 more.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So that could be bad on Apple.
Yeah. And again, it's either the consumer will pay it, or the company will have to kind of cut their margin essentially to keep the prices the same.
Yeah.
So it's something that you want to be aware of. You don't want to have, you know, 75% of your portfolio that would be dinged by these tariffs.
Right.
Realistically, you're going to have a portion of your portfolio that may get hurt by these tariffs. I don't want to say there's pretty much no way to avoid it, and I don't think you should avoid it,
right,
because that means you're not having exposure and you're not having a good, sound, diversified portfolio, but you just want to be aware, making sure it's not like 75, 80% of your portfolio is going to have huge problems if these tariffs go through.
Yeah.
Just be realistic. Make sure your portfolio does have, you know, that exposure limited, but again, be realistic with yourself here. If you have, you know, 20% of your portfolio that may get hit by it, that's not going to necessarily be a problem.
Yeah, and this is why we talk about investing. You've got to look at what you own in the portfolio. You've got to say, is this going to be affected? Because again, if you've got your portfolio is 20 companies and 18 of them have some products being, you know, dealing with China, you're going to have some big hits if things don't go right quickly. And I do believe it's not going to happen in 2 weeks. This is going to take some time to get this resolved with the tariffs, but it's just make sure you got good quality business in your portfolio.
Well, it's just not even the tariffs, but what is China's response going to be? And why we do think China is not operating from as strong of a position in the past, I don't think they're just going to take it. I mean, you know, they've had this big push towards nationalism as well and being kind of prideful in their own domestic companies.
Right.
But to be honest, that doesn't bode well for an Apple, you know, either way.
Yeah, either way. And China, yeah, that they're in a difficult position. You're right. They're very proudful of who they are, but they want to do better. And they know that they've got to turn things around. And they worked with Trump pretty well before, you know, to some degree.
Yeah. I don't know if they did go back and forth. You know, it wasn't like, Mr. Trump, yeah, whatever.
When they
were
in a strong position, now you're not a strong position. So it's going to be interesting to play out and how it does, but I think we'll see.
I think it will, and this is why I think 2025 is going to be a difficult year. I think there will definitely be volatility because of these negotiations with China.
And we see volatility as a good thing because that means things will go down. Oh, we can use some of our cash to invest in some good businesses at good prices. Let's talk about inflation because is inflation continuing to cool? Well, the October Consumer Price Index, CPI, showed price gains came in with expectations, in line with expectations. Headline CPI increased 2.6% compared to last year, and core CPI, which excludes food and energy, climbed 3.3%. The headline CPI was above September's reading of 2.4%, and core CPI matched September's reading of 3.3%. According to economists, the monthly inflation rate in October 2023 was unusually low, which made the October 2024 reading look relatively high. Hopefully, this means we'll see further progress in the months ahead, as core CPI has not shown much progress as of late, as it's been stuck around 3.2-3.3% or so since May's 3.4% reading. While much of this sounds problematic, there are not many areas of concern when looking at the inflation report. The major issue continues to be shelter, which rose 4.9% compared to last year and accounted for over 65% of the annual increases in core CPI.
Yeah, and I mean, essentially, we've been at 3.2 or 3.3% for about 6 months now. So, I mean, we saw this drastic improvement in core CPI. I think what it was around 6-7% on the core CPI to come back down to, again, around that 3.5-ish% level. And now we just haven't seen much progress for the last 6 months. But again, I do want to point out that I continue to believe that shelter inflation will eventually resolve itself, because that has been such a big problem propping up the overall inflation level, which would then bring the major inflation measures more in line with the Fed's desired level, which is 2% on the PCE or the core PCE. Powell even said during a press conference, market rents, newly signed leases are experiencing very low inflation. And we've talked about this before. But he also mentioned that the current shelter inflation readings are due to a catch-up problem, and it's not really reflecting current inflationary pressures. Again, it kind of begs the question. It's like, how important is the CPI data? It's not even inflecting upon current inflationary measures. It's kind of silly to me. But I do believe that with this report, a December cut, it does look likely, but that would not leave room for as many cuts in 2025. Based on the current data, I believe a Fed funds rate around 3.5% would be a fair level, and that compares to a current Fed funds rate of 4.5-4.75%. That means if there is a cut in December, we could be looking at maybe just 3 or 4 rate cuts next year.
Yeah, and I got a couple things here. Let me go back to the shelter costs, because I believe at one point, they were up like 7% year over year. It was much higher, so it seems to be coming
down.
It's
coming down.
Coming down. And also, too, it accounted for, I think, 70, maybe even more than 70%. Now it's down to 65%. So we are seeing that come down. My other concern is on the cuts. I guess PCE comes out, is it Wednesday, Thursday?
I'm not sure if it's next week or the following. I know it comes out closer to the end of the month.
At this point, I'm still not convinced we'll get a rate cut in December.
Right now, the markets have it priced at about, I think it was 58-60%.
That's so about, I'm 50-50, I think is where I'm
yeah.
at.
Yeah. And I mean, even Powell came out and said that the economy is not sending any signals that we need to be in a hurry to lower rates.
Yes.
Which I would agree with. But I think if they don't go in December, they go in January. And where I think you could see them kind of take the rate cuts is an every other approach.
Right.
So if they do that, if they don't cut in December, then they would cut in January, and then they would wait the next meeting, then cut the following meeting. And just kind of playing around with it, the Fed meets about 8 times, or not about, they meet 8 times during the year. So if they did cut in December and then did 3 rate cuts next year, that would put them at a target range of 3.5-3.75%. And I mean, frankly, when I look at these numbers, I think that that is a fair Fed funds rate. The reason for that, and we've talked about this before, the 10-year note normally has about a 1-1.5% discrepancy over.
I think it's more like 1.5 to 2.
I believe it's 1-1.5. I believe we did this before, and I believe it's about 1-1.5.
Yeah, we'll have to look at that, see.
We'll have to look at it. But if you're at 3.5, that means the 10-year's at 4.5, which is where we're at now. So you cut that down. The 10-year, I don't think, is going to move much. And then, you know, mortgages should kind of narrow, because right now the spread between mortgages and the 10-year's is, as Robert Behig has talked about, is a lot higher. So maybe that can come down a little bit more. But we talk about inflation at 3%. I mean, it's not 9% inflation like it was. A 3% inflation rate, I think, is quite manageable. And I think having these restrictive, overly restrictive interest rates could cause some more problems to the economy. It's just a very hard balance they have to act. And I think the reason I say a 3.5 to 3.75% Fed funds rate, I think is potentially what they call the terminal rate or the neutral rate, where it's not necessarily accommodative, but it's not restrictive any longer.
Right. And the 3% inflation rate is not bad at all if you have a nice growth in the GDP of, we'll say, 3 to 4% because the economy's growing, people have jobs, like, okay, a little bit of inflation, but we can handle it. That's what I think is going to happen once we get through the tariff situation. We get things going, because I think President-elect Trump is going to act as quickly as he can. He's already appointing people. I think when's the inauguration? The 20th?
January 20th,
yeah, January 20th. I think he's going to hit the ground running and a lot of changes very quickly. So I think there's some good things ahead. I'll put it that way.
Yeah, now, like I said, I just don't think – you know, rate cuts should necessarily drive your portfolio decisions, because the 10-year I don't think is going to be moving as much as people anticipate. But right now, I still think it's very plausible we get to a total of 4 more rate cuts by the end of next year.
Right. And also, I mean, we do have some real estate in the portfolio, which that could be affected by interest rates. But again, I think if the economy does well, the real estate will do well because they're commercial properties and so forth. So, all right. Well, that all comes from our newsletter. If you want to sign up for our free newsletter, it goes out every Friday at 5 o'clock. Other topics you'll see there. Could we see even more stock buybacks and dividend increases? Yes, another reason why we believe the S&P 500 will fall back with strong reasons. Check them out. The delivery war between Federal Express and UPS could benefit you this holiday season. And did you get burned by long-term care insurance back in the 90s? We talk about that as well. All this is free information. Go to our website, smartinvesting2000.com. Again, that's smartinvesting2000.com. Sign up for it right there. And also, too, you can go to the YouTube channel, Smart Investing Show, and you'll see the videos. They're usually about 2 to 3 minutes long, talking about the same information there. All right, let's change gears here and let's talk about financial planning. For that, we turn to our financial planning expert, Harrison Johnson. Harrison, how you doing?
I'm doing well, guys. How are you doing?
Good, good. I like this one, work income versus retirement income. Those are two really different things.
They are, and that's the point I want to make. So when you're planning for retirement, it's important to understand the difference between your work income and your retirement income. If you get paid, let's say, $200,000 a year, which is close to $17,000 a month, of that, you're paying taxes, you might be saving some of it, so your net paycheck might be closer to $10,000 a month. If you go into retirement with the idea that you need to replace that entire $200,000 of income to continue your lifestyle, it's just not true. In retirement, you're not paying payroll taxes, which in California is a flat rate of 8.75%, so pretty high. You're typically not saving much more in retirement. And if you plan properly, you're going to be paying less federal and state taxes as well. So in this scenario, Social Security alone might be between $5,000 and $6,000 a month for a married couple, which means any retirement savings just need to cover the remaining living expense need, and a nest egg of about $1 million should be able to do that if it's invested appropriately, even after taxes are considered. We see retirees all the time where their income potential, or the maximum amount they can spend without running out of money, is much larger than what they're currently living on, and they have no idea. So if you're planning for retirement, know how much you actually need so you can either A, retire earlier, or B, at least have the peace of mind knowing that you are financially independent and you don't have to keep working if you don't need to.
And, you know, Harrison, this is so important because it's very scary when people retire, because they are going from collecting a paycheck to now they don't have that any longer. And they just don't know and understand. And you've done this many times for people retiring. There's so many things that they don't know about that a good financial planner like yourself can bring it up. Will you talk about these things like, oh, I didn't realize that?
And I mean, that's exactly right, Brian, because a lot of people, I would say the vast majority of people, have a fear of, okay, well, I get a paycheck every 2 weeks, and now I'm never going to get a paycheck again. You know, where is my income going to come from? And, you know, Social Security or pensions, that covers a portion of it, but that's where your investable assets come in to fill in that gap. And the way to think about a 401k or an IRA or a Roth IRA or, you know, any investment account is that is a source of income. It's, you know, you grow it so when you're working, but ultimately the purpose of that is to create an income source. So that's the way it needs to be invested, and that's the way you need to look at it. So you can decide, okay, well, how much do I need to live on in retirement? How much of that is covered by Social Security? And then of my nest egg, how much income can that reasonably create? Is that enough? And if you do it correctly, you know, a lot of people find out that they have the income potential, they just don't know it yet.
And I think the great point you had in there as well, they're all great points, but the fact that you're no longer saving for retirement in retirement, that's generally a huge expense because, you know, I mean, and this could be a very big swing for people. You know, let's say you go from as a married couple, I'm just going to make the numbers easy. I mean, let's say you're putting the $30,000 each into your 401k so you can kind of get to those retirement goals. I mean, shoot, that's $60,000 a year. Now, there could be some tax benefits on that if it is all pre-tax, but I mean, that is no longer a major expense that you then have maybe 2-3 years later, not to mention if you're working and you're paying for health insurance. If you're now 65 and you go on Medicare, I mean, that could be a swing in terms of what was coming out of your paycheck before that is no longer an expense or at least at the same level.
Exactly. So again, your work income in many cases is a lot higher than what your retirement income looks like. However, that doesn't necessarily mean the cash flow is different. In many cases, people will have a higher salary with a lower level of take-home pay. And then in retirement, they'll have a lower level of retirement income, but a higher level of take-home pay just because, again, you're not saving, you're paying less taxes, and all of those things.
And one thing I just kind of realized, too, though, is that now you're retired, you have more free time. Hopefully don't spend it in the store spending money.
So it's all relative, right? Because that's definitely true. You know, you get into retirement and now 40 hours a week, you've got just extra free time. So you might be going on more trips. You might be spending more money. You might be doing more activities. So that obviously needs to be baked into it. But again, when you're planning for retirement, again, differentiate between the work income and the retirement income that you have. I mean, it is possible that people spend more in retirement because they're doing more things. That usually doesn't last throughout their whole retirement. You know, that might be the first 10 or 15 years or so. And after that, you slow down a little bit. And that's, you know, where more of the details get in. But again, saving for retirement and then building that cash flow from your investable assets and having a good idea of what that will reasonably generate in retirement is so important for planning.
Great. Well, Harrison, thank you very much. We appreciate it. Have a good weekend. We'll see you on Monday.
All right. Thanks, guys. We'll see you Monday.
Okay. Bye-bye. That, again, is Harrison Johnson. He is our financial planner at Wilsey Asset Management. He is a CFP. He's a fee-based planner. He's not going to try to sell you annuities or life insurance. If you want a free consultation with him to kind of talk about, gee, are we going to retire? What's going to happen? Go to the website, smartinvesting2000.com. That's smartinvesting2000.com, and send him an email. Or come at the office, 858-224-0004. Again, 858-224-0004. Going to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to talk about Honeywell, Domino's Pizza, and Bristol Myers Squibb. Stay with us. You're listening to Smart Investing Show with Brenton Chase. Alrighty, welcome back to the second half of the Smart Investing Show. This is where we cover companies, look at them for investing, help educate you on what we look at as far as investing in fundamentals, trying to point you in the right direction.
I'm sorry. I don't know what just made me think of it, but when we were talking about investing, I was like, you know, we talk about building a good portfolio. I was watching CNBC this morning, and Cathie Wood was on.
Oh, I've not heard that name in a while.
And she was talking about, well, you know, the ARK fund, it is more volatile, so it should only be like a sliver of people's portfolios.
Really?
And I was like, well, then what's the point? I might as well just buy a sliver of Tesla if I'm going to buy a vault. I'm like, gee, that was just crazy to me. Like, what is the point of buying your fund then? Like, might as well just buy a single stock that's risky.
And we always talk about that too. Well, just this is important to talk about it, is that, okay, a sliver, is that 1%? So what that would mean is if you have 1% of your portfolio and that doubled in price— okay, you added 1% to your return.
And I'm telling you, she has 15% of the portfolio still in Tesla. If I was going to take that chance, I'd much rather just buy 1% of Tesla.
Yeah. Bragging rights on Tesla.
Yeah. So I bring this up because when we're looking at these companies, again, we spend so much time researching them because these should be larger stakes when you're buying these companies, not a small sliver
yes.
of your portfolio in a risky ETF.
Yeah, I mean, that's why we spend, because we always talk about, we spend 10, 15, 20 hours before you put these in our portfolio, which you should be doing as well. and it would not be a small sliver.
Totally off topic, but I just was sitting here thinking about it, and I was like, wait a minute, I got to say this.
Yeah, no, I'm glad you did, because that's a good point. We try to educate people on investing. That was a very important point. But let's look at the company here, Honeywell. I'm sure you heard of the company, symbol HON. They're in the industry of conglomerates. Not much short on it, 1.2%, 81% institutional owned. We do see a PE ratio not very good to start with, 26.6 versus 13.5. Price of sales is expensive, 4 versus 0.8. And again, these are valuation ratios. You want the number lower than the industry average. Price of book value, 8.6 versus 1.3. Price of cash flow for Honeywell, 22.3 versus 13.4. The only good thing here is the PEG ratio, which is your price earnings divided by the growth, 2.7 versus 6.3. And that's really high in the industry, 63.5. Look at the earnings over the last year. They're up 7.3%. The industry climbed by 23.5%. We do see sales up 4% for Honeywell. Industry up 15.9%. The five-year growth rate, and this is where it changes for Honeywell, up 8.1% is the expectation on the five-year earnings per share growth estimate versus 1.7 for the industry. So it sounds like the industry had a lot going in the rearview mirror, but going forward, Honeywell could do better. Honeywell does pay a 2% dividend, use 49.6% of the earnings to pay that out. That's okay. I wish it was a little bit higher. We do see on the balance sheet, current ratio, well, that's 1.4, same as the industry. Debt to equity, not as good as I would like it to be. It's a 1.8 versus 1.2. We do see a net profit margin, very good for Honeywell, 15 versus 6.4. And also return on equity is 32.7 versus 13.3. And we like a return on equity above 15. So that's a positive there. Chase, what do you got going forward?
Yeah, I'm just going to say a little bummed here. I mean, we don't really have anything like a Honeywell, like an industrial company like this right in the portfolio. I wanted to like this business, so I'll get more into the numbers. But what was really intriguing was Elliott, the activist firm, they took a $5 billion plus or minus stake in the company, and they're really pushing to have Honeywell break itself into two businesses. And Elliott actually believes if Honeywell were to separate its aerospace and automation businesses, shareholders could see 75% upside within 2 years.
Oh, wow.
So, I mean, they see a lot of expectations there. And, I mean, it's interesting. I mean, $5 billion is not a small stake, but Honeywell does have a $150 billion market cap. So it is about 3.3% of the overall company. So not enough to necessarily sway people. I think they'd have to really get in there with management, have management trust them, or really sway over a lot of the shareholders to have some changes implemented since it is such a small portion there. Looking at the numbers, though, for Honeywell, it's $228.99 is the current price. The 52-week range is $189.66 as the low. The high is $242.77, and they did get a bump after the announcement of the Elliott stake as obviously excitement that maybe more money could come into this stock.
Right.
Going forward, though, and this is where I'm going to say I'm kind of surprised of that 75% gain. I mean, they'd really have to find a lot of efficiencies within splitting those two companies. Because you got to December 2025, the estimated earnings per share is $11.05. You get a target sell price of $183.43. The stock trades at nearly 21 times earnings currently. I just looked up kind of GE. And GE now trades at over 30 times year's earnings. So I don't know if they're like, well, you know, if we split up, we could get that type of multiple on the Honeywell business.
Right.
And to me, that's a big if.
Right.
And I just, like I said, I wanted to like it, but it's too expensive. And, you know, we've seen, I mean, frankly, we talked about the split up of GE and how successful that's been. 3M now went that route as well. I would not be surprised if Honeywell does start to split up this businesses as conglomerates just are not as successful as they used to be.
You know, and Elliott Management, I mean, they did pay a high price for this, which I'm kind of surprised with, but it is difficult because we know that a lot of these PE firms, a lot of these rating firms, they have a lot of cash.
Yeah.
And if they don't do something, people say, you know what, I'm taking my money back. You're not doing anything with it.
Yeah.
So I think they're almost forced to do something that they might feel uncomfortable doing, but they know if they do nothing, they're going to lose the money anyways. So let's invest it, and hopefully we can do some real great things here to have that money grow, because I can't believe they paid that much for this, because you're right. It's they got to do a lot to get this up 75% in 2 years. I don't see it.
Yeah, and I mean, I don't know enough, and I don't have enough time here on the show to kind of split up into the automation and aerospace businesses. But I mean, what type of multiples are you trying to get on that? Is there going to be some expenses that could easily be removed from one of those companies to help drive earnings higher? I mean, there's a lot of question marks. But again, a 75% appreciation, that has to have a major impact of a rating on the multiple that goes way up.
Right.
You know, the multiple would now have to go up to 30 times, and your earnings growth would have to be phenomenal to get a 75% gain on the stock. So I think it's wishful thinking, and I unfortunately would not recommend buying Honeywell, even with the news.
And wasn't Elliott the one that invested in Southwest Airlines?
I believe it was them.
I wonder if they sold out of that position and that's where this cash came from. Are they? I do believe these guys are sitting on a lot of cash.
Yeah, potentially.
Yeah. So, and I don't think the Southwest Airlines has done very well lately.
I have not followed Southwest Airlines, so I'm not sure.
Yeah. So, all right. Well, let's move on to the next company. Let's talk. I'm kind of hungry. Let's talk about pizza. Let's talk about Domino's Pizza. You know, they've been around forever. And, you know, I don't remember the last time I got a Domino's Pizza. Do you?
No.
When you were growing up, we used to get them all the time.
Yeah, I mean, we like to make our own pizza now, and you know, my wife makes really good pizza dough, so you know, we compete with Domino's, I guess. It is nice to obviously buy pizza; we don't have to make it. But yeah, I just can't even remember the last time I had Domino's pizza.
Well, let's see if we should be buying Domino's
pizza. I bought a lot of it when I had just graduated from college.
Yeah, I'm hungry. Let's eat pizza.
It was cheap, easy way. Just hanging out with the guys. Yeah, let's get some pizza.
You know, I think I want to do a pizza and beer party. I want to do that. My wife says, no, that's too cheap. It's like, no, it's fun. So anyways, maybe we'll order Domino's Pizza. But let's look at if you should order the stock here. Their symbol is DPZ. They're in the restaurant industry. Shares on the flow side starting to rise 5.6%. Not worrisome yet, but higher than I think would normally be. We do see that they have a high P/E ratio of 26.5 versus 29.4. Price of sales 3.2 versus 2.7. Ooh, no price to book value. That's kind of concerning to me because that means you take away all the liabilities from the assets. There's no value to this company at all. Price of cash flow is expensive, 24.6 versus 18.4. Now, we do see the earnings per share over the last year up 11.4. That's very good, especially compared to the industry growth of 1.9%. Sales for Domino's, they keep growing. Last year up 4.4%, while the industry experienced a decline of 0.3%. The analysts do not give Domino's Pizza any 5-year estimate on their earnings going forward. They do pay a dividend, 1.4%, use 35% of their earnings to pay that out. That's sustainable. No problem there. We do see on the balance sheet, current ratio 1.7 versus 1.1. That's a big positive, but there's no debt to equity because remember, they have no equity. So therefore, any debt is kind of at risk, I'll put it. We do see a net profit margin 12.3 versus 9.1. Return equity a negative 14.4, so maybe they just lost that equity recently. I'll try to take a look at that while, Chase, you're looking at the earnings there. We do see return on capital is a positive 62.6, so they probably do have a lot of debt. What do you got?
I was going to say with this company as well, you got to remember it is a franchise model,
right, franchise
so they are
model.
Asset light, which, again, I mean, we've talked about this before, but, I mean, frankly, even if the numbers look good, I don't think we'd buy it because it's just, the debt levels don't fit our philosophy because the asset-light business model, there's no equity because there's really not many assets.
Yeah, they do have $5.2 billion in debt.
Yeah, yeah. So, we don't like it as much, but the debt-to-EBITDA ratio, I mean, that's really where you got to start to look at, can you cover the debt with cash flow and what those kind of look like? But, that's a bummer there that the debt is $5.2 billion. That sounds quite high.
That's high, yeah.
Looking at the price here for Domino's Pizza, again, their ticker symbol is DPZ. It's $430.43, 50-week range. The low is $367.24, and the high is $542.75. I'm going to give you the number first, and then I'll tell you why we were interested in buying this company, kind of going backwards, but, make for, I think, a better conversation. Going out to December 2025, I see estimated earnings per share is $17.65. It gives us a target sell price of $292.99, well below the current price of $430.43. And I will say that is quite surprising because, I mean, this year they're looking for earnings growth of 14%, but next year earnings growth of 5%.
What? That's low.
That's very low for a multiple of 24 times those earnings. I mean, I'm quite surprised by that.
I'm trying to think, what would cause a pizza company to slow down? Saturation?
Maybe.
No. I mean, you got. I mean, you
Papa
got
Papa John's. You got John,
competition. Yeah.
You got competition. I mean, I'm not
wait,
sure.
Wait, is Amazon coming out with pizza?
Maybe. But I will say that the big reason we looked at this stock was I was quite surprised by this, but there was headlines that Berkshire did buy 1.3 million shares, which gives them about a 3.6% stake in Domino's Pizza. I will say it's valued at $550 million, which sounds like a lot of money, but you think about it. He owns about $41 billion of American Express, $28 billion of Coca-Cola, $31 billion of Bank of America, $550 million of Domino's. It's a very small piece of Berkshire, which again makes me think this was not Warren Buffett. And it seems like more and more of these headlines are not due to his decisions any longer. It seems like it's, again, I always maybe transpose the names, but Ted Wexler and Todd Combs, it seems right. like, or it could be Todd Wexler and Ted Combs.
I think it's Todd Combs.
Yeah. Could be their decisions here.
I do wonder what's going on over there in Omaha because it seems like maybe these guys are kind of like testing things. There's a couple other buys that we saw, like Ulta Beauty. Who's the other one that surprised me?
Pool Corp.
Like, what are they doing? I mean, they sold. You said they sold Ulta.
Well, that is what made
it's
me
very
go
strange.
Like, that is a weird transition. I mean, we saw the Paramount situation where I think Buffett, and he did say that was his decision, but I think he gave that over a year.
Right.
Ulta Beauty, they bought that in Q2, and then they essentially sold their entire stake that they had purchased in Q3.
Right.
So a quarter. Like, that is not Buffett's philosophy. That is not his approach. That is not long-term investing. A quarter.
Not at all.
It's like, wow, what did they not do enough research on the company before they bought it to give it a quarter?
Yeah.
I mean, it's just.
And we think they lost
odd.
Money on Ulta Beauty.
It could have.
It looked like it. Possibly wrong, but yeah. So, and it is kind of strange as well that the way things are going. It just doesn't seem like a Warren Buffett run company. And I followed him for, gosh, my whole career, and I've never seen things like that going on now. So, all right, we got one more company, but let's talk about real estate. For that, we'll talk to our real estate expert, Robert Behick from Countywide Mortgage Lending. Robert, how are you doing today?
Fantastic, guys. How are you?
Well, a little bit confused. I don't know what a NMBA forecast is and a 2025 DSCR type loan is. And so a lot of people have, well, what are those? So you got to explain it to us.
The National Mortgage Bankers Association, NMBA, and then DSCR, Debt Service Cover Ratio. What the heck is that? It just came up again in our office this week. Yeah, this is why folks really need to talk to somebody. Got a young man who has a job, works every day, but he drives Uber at night, gets a 1099, and writes it off on his taxes like he should. But he's a Schedule C employee, and because he's a Schedule C employee, his $1,100 Tesla payment that he drives Uber with, we actually have to count against him. So a different way of helping this young man get into a home is to be able to use bank statements. And so we look at his bank statements instead of his tax returns, and we make sure that he can still afford the debt. This is not like the old days where we just stated your income. We actually look at what flows in, and then we will give you a loan just based on your tax returns if you have some self-employment income.
So you can kind of look through that because you're kind of maybe more like cash flow versus, well, it's just depreciation on that Tesla. Is that what you're able to do by the bank statements?
It is, because you look at what he wrote off on his taxes. He, of course, wrote off his car payment because he has a work truck, another vehicle. So the Tesla is strictly really for driving Uber. He's got it separated, but yet in the normal way of lending, we would have to count that, again, that debt against him, and that just knocks him out of the a ballpark. So if he would have opened up a business bank account, and a lot of young folks don't understand just because they're 1099, if they have a separate bank account that's, you know, a business bank account, it could have got around this. But it's just getting bad advice or no advice at all.
And I got to ask a question here, because is this talking about the 2025 DSCR type loan? Is that what we're talking about, or is it something different?
It is. It's, we're looking at these types of loans that we just came back from a conference, and they're forecasting a huge increase in these coming into 2025. And a lot of it has to do with folks that are now self-employed who used to be employees. And so as small businesses start, or they have a second job as a small business, we're going to be looking at more of these types of loans out there in the marketplace than we ever have before.
I know you mentioned that he, you know, didn't get advice or got bad advice, but having that separate business account may be very helpful in the loan process. How long should he have that account, or should somebody have that account set up before maybe it helps on getting the mortgage?
12 months.
I was going to say, it'd be so great, you know, it's like, oh, you messed up, but maybe you just, you know, do it for 3 months and then you could really improve the mortgage situation. But 12 months is a long time, unfortunately. So, yeah, you got to make sure you're doing things right.
Yeah. No, believe me, we look at all those things going, can we do this for 90 days? You're absolutely right, Jake. No, it's a year.
And this is just something else that you can look at, because I've never heard of it before. I don't know if you had, Chase.
No.
It's just something that is, and I think you said it's fairly new. People come in like, well, I want to do this. And my other guy said I can't do it because of my write-offs from my Tesla and so forth. You're saying, no, wait, we do have this other thing you can look at.
There are a lot of folks that we get the opportunity to work with that the real estate agent or financial planner introduces us to them because they got turned down somewhere else, for sure.
And so people remember the name again so they can ask, it's what again?
It's a DSCR, or debt service cover ratio loan.
I like that. I think I'll remember that. How about you, Jason?
I mean, I'm technically W-2 employee, so I don't have to worry about it at this point in time. But
we can change that.
You
work for me.
Call me.
No, you're not taking Chase from me. Well, Robert, thank you very much. We appreciate the information, and you have a great weekend.
You too. Take care, guys.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Again, that's Robert B. Hick from Countywide Mortgage Lending. You can contact him directly at 760-443-3821. Again, that's 760-443-3821. Or go to countywidemtg.com. Again, countywidemtg.com. Right there at the website, send an email and ask about the 2025 DSCR type loan.
And just a reminder here, Countywide Mortgage Lending is a division of Golden Empire Mortgage, Inc., NMLS number 1104585, licensed by the Department of Financial Protection and Innovation under the California Residential Mortgage Lending Act. Countywide Mortgage Lending is an equal housing lender and proud member of the BBB.
Well, Chase, let's talk about, kind of flip-flop this. Normally, you talk about the company, then we talk about reasons behind it. Let's kind of flip-flop that around, because we're going to talk about drug company Bristol Myers Squibb. And the reason for that is with the appointment of
RFK.
RFK. I almost said JFK. RFK. I know it's HHS, I think, House Health or something, but anyways.
I'm pulling it up here, yeah.
I mean, I
forget what it said. I've looked at it so many times today, I keep forgetting what the H
It's going to make a big change in the drug area. And so this could be buying opportunities, but we want to talk about a drug company because perhaps, I mean, I know on Friday they got hit pretty hard after the appointment on Thursday. Did you find it?
Yeah, it's the Department of Health and Human Services. I knew health was one of the H's. I was like, what is the second H?
And I like that hat. I think you said your wife wants one. Make America Healthy Again.
Yeah, MAHA. Yep. So it is one thing that, you know, I've talked about this. I think we mentioned it last week on the show, but, you know, the pharmaceutical companies, I think there will be changes. Yeah. Now, are they going to get driven out of business? I don't think so.
I hope not. We need drug companies. I'm sorry.
But, I mean, there could be some changes to the regulatory environment. There could be maybe some more vaccine skepticism, which could hurt overall sales. So, I mean, there are things that you need to be very cognizant of. And if you are looking at this space, you have to make sure you are not buying an expensive drug company.
Yeah.
Because if you have one that is valued too highly on the earnings and things do slow down, those are going to be the ones that get hit the hardest. If you do have one that, you know, is trading at attractive valuations, I don't think the downside risk is nearly as bad as the at-risk companies of high valuations.
And also, too, we always talk about you've got to understand what that business is. And one thing, too, with drug companies, I think if they have a lot of vaccination revenue coming in, that could be a problem. It seems like that's what RFK wants to do, is really, he doesn't want to eliminate them. We talk about this a lot. He just wants to make it so that they're safer, that they do enough tests on them, that
more transparent.
You have the choice. You're not forced to do something, which makes a lot of sense to me.
Yeah, I mean, it makes sense. It'll just be very interesting to see how analysts start to perceive what changes could come and how that will impact earnings, because I think there will be an impact on earnings. It's just the magnitude is what we'll have to see what happens there.
Yeah. So make sure you're not overpaying a drug company. So let's look at the Bristol Myers Squibb. Their symbol is BMY. They're a drug manufacturer. Not much short on the float side, 1.1%. Unfortunately, the start, no P.E. ratio versus 36.6 for the industry. Price of sales, 2.4 versus 4.4. That's a positive. Price to book value, 6.7, about the same as the industry at 5.9. But price to cash flow does come in at 7.6, better than the industry at 17.4. And there's no PEG ratio versus 7.5 for the industry. So that's disappointing. I like to see a PEG ratio. We do see the earnings of last year, no growth there. Industry was up 17.5%. Sales, well, they were up 5.6%. Now, this is better than the industry, up 1.4. And here again, the analysts have no estimated growth on the earnings per share going forward for the next 5 years. You get a nice dividend, kind of normal for drug companies, about 4.3%. The payout ratio, nothing there. So I think there's something with this company that they've lost money over the last 12 months or something. We'll have to dig a little bit deeper into that. We do see that they have a current ratio of 1.2, same as the industry. Uh-oh, a debt to equity of 3 versus 2.2. I'm just saying, be aware of high-tech companies. I'll check the debt while you're looking at the numbers there, but that's pretty high, 3.0. We'll see if we can find something on that for you. Also, too, they got a lot of intangible assets as well, 52%. So high debt, high intangibles, not good. Net profit margin, a negative 15.3 versus a positive 12.1. Wow, return equity, a negative 42.3 versus 27.8. This is either going to be a great buy or a terrible buy is where we're going to be at. What do you got?
Yeah, and I did want to say, I mean, on the debt side, that's a huge concern. I mean, 300% debt to equity is atrocious. And you know, a lot of these big pharma companies, what they do is they have these patent cliffs, essentially, where their drugs, they follow a patent. Now, they don't make much money off of them. So what they do is they have to either internally develop drugs,
yeah,
or they go buy other drugs.
Yeah.
It seems like Bristol Myers has really gone the direction of acquiring other companies, and especially with that large intangible asset base and a high debt to equity, I just have to assume that's due to acquisitions. The big question is, are those acquisitions paying off? Are they generating cash flow for this company? Especially if things do slow down for the industry, they're going to have to repay that debt, and it could be a major issue.
And also, too, what could happen going forward is that, you know, you got all this debt and the drug doesn't pass FDA. Oh, my gosh, you're in a real bad situation. Or it could be tougher to pass going forward with RFK. We'll see.
Yeah, we'll see. But let's look at the numbers here.
Sure.
Current price for Bristol Myers Squibb, again, their ticker symbol is BMY. It's $56.22. The 52-week range, the low, $39.35. And the high is $61.08. So it has come off that low. But going forward, some strange numbers here. And this might kind of play into what you were looking at. But the current estimate for earnings per share in 2024, I know the target sale price is off 2025, but the 2024 numbers is very interesting. Estimated earnings per share of 90 cents. That's a decline of 88% over year on earnings.
What are they doing here? This was not a good pick we got for people.
Well, but the interesting thing is it looks like there was a lot of write-offs, and this may have been from bad acquisitions or something, because now you go out to December 2025, the estimated earnings per share is $7.05.
That's
so that looks quite intriguing and actually gives you a target sell price of $117.03, meaning the forward PE's about 8.5 times, and the earnings growth is 681%. Now, they're not growing earnings at 681% because sales are growing. This is definitely something with write-offs or, you know, impairment charges, restructuring charges that happened in 2024. What those are, I'm not quite sure, but you know, that could be a problem you'd have to dive down into.
And I have to apologize to people because I thought this might be a good buy for people. I did look at the debt. Their debt is $50.1 billion. Now, just 2 years ago, it was $37.9 billion. So they borrowed a lot of money to do something here. So stay away from this. And unfortunately, there's a closing bell. We got to wrap it up. So thanks for listening to the Smart Investing Show. It is for informational purposes only and should not be used as investment advice. If you'd like to discuss in more detail your investment needs, have other investment questions, feel free to call myself, Brent Wilsey, or Chase Wilsey at 858-224-0004. Again, 858-224-0004. Or go to the website, smartinvesting2000.com. Again, that's smartinvesting2000.com. You'll listen to the podcast there. Also, too, on YouTube, The Smart Investing Show. You got those videos at about 2 to 3 minutes long of great information for you. Thanks for listening. We'll be back next week right here on The Smart Investing Show.
I did all that, and may I say,